Isis Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of Moving Targets, Spider Shepherd, SAS. Written by Stephen Leather and read by Paul Thornley. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Isis Publishing Limited. Chapter 1. Sabit Kusen trudged wearily along the dusty street, heading home from the market where he had spent all day squatting in the dirt, trying to sell the cooking pots and water jars that his father pounded into shape in the tiny forge alongside their house. There had been only one customer all day, and he had beaten Sabit down in price, twice walking off in apparent disgust before returning to grudgingly buy a pot for a price that would barely pay for the family's bread. Once a welcome refuge from the desert, a bustling, prosperous oasis and resting place, the modern town of Turguan now had little to offer travellers. Most of the buildings were one- or two-storey mud-brick houses, separated by crumbling alleyways. There were a few drab concrete apartment and office blocks close to the town centre, but they were shoddily designed and even more shoddily built, corrupt government officials and contractors having siphoned off much of the money to construct them. There were a few cars and diesel-belching lorries on the streets, but also carts pulled by donkeys and buffaloes, while strings of scrawny camels plodded along, laden with bales of the traditional fabrics that had long been the pride of Sabit's people and their principal export. High on its windswept plateau, it was a place of extremes, burning hot by day with summer temperatures of over 40 degrees C, though even then it was bitterly cold at night. In winter, it could be 20 degrees below freezing, and the biting north winds howling over the desert brought flurries of ice and gritty sand that stung the skin like hornets. The isolated town was surrounded by mountains and deserts. To the west and northwest, the jagged snow-laden peaks seemed to pierce the sky. To the north and east, the dunes began, a desert so vast that even the nomads roamed only the fringes of it. The sun bleached bones of animals and men in the million square miles of burning sands showed that none could survive in that wasteland. A modern highway crossed the fringes of the desert. A straight line ruled across the landscape like a Roman road. Outside the town, the only man-made structures were the steel skeletons of nodding donkey pumps extracting the oil that was both the blessing and the curse of this remote region, bringing a few much-needed jobs, but also ensuring that the government would fight to the death to defeat any campaign for independence. Even in his short lifetime, Sabit could remember farmers coaxing crops from the dry, stony fields that surrounded the town, the dust from their ploughs drifting like smoke through the streets. Now the dunes had advanced right up to the edge of the town and drifts of shifting sand were spilling into the streets, threatening to engulf it altogether. An ancient road bisected the town from east to west, a trade route that had been used beyond the memories of men. For 5 days that road had been blocked by protesters, among them Sabit's father, uncle and brothers. It was an all-male household, for Sabit's mother had died giving birth to him. Sabit's father, Rabia Kusen, was one of the town elders. They gathered every Friday to drink green tea and discuss the town's affairs, though their discussions and conclusions were merely symbolic, for all power was concentrated in the capital, Beijing, 1,000 miles away. Only rarely in their history had Sabit's people governed themselves. Down the centuries, a succession of warlords and tyrants had conquered the region and ruled it with blood and iron. Already cowed by decades of repression, the people had reacted with sullen, resentful acquiescence to the ever-growing number of petty restrictions upon them. However, a small spark, the arrest of an imam for anti-state activities, had ignited a blaze of protest. The town's young men took to the region and bottles. The police responded with clubs, tear gas and water cannons, and 150 youths were arrested. Stripped of their coats and jackets, beaten and tortured, they were held for a week in freezing conditions, made worse by being doused daily with cold water, By the end of the week, 50 of them had died, and many of the survivors were suffering from frostbite. As news of the atrocity spread, popular outrage outweighed the fear of reprisals, and protests flared again, growing into open rebellion. The protesters marched on the central police station, demanding the release of the remaining captives, and when that was refused, they stormed the building, smashing the windows, battering down the doors, freeing the prisoners and attacking their tormentors, the state police. They wrecked the building and made a bonfire of all the files and documents they found there, including the intelligence files held on every citizen. Having ransacked the building, the protesters overturned police and government vehicles and erected barricades on the main road. Then banners began appearing, demanding self-rule and independence from the hated regime. Most of the protesters were relatively peaceful, but a handful, more passionate or more reckless than the rest, began beating ethnic Chinese immigrants and looting and burning their houses. Before long, the smell of oily smoke hung heavily in the air. Sabit's father and the other elders grew increasingly concerned at the escalation of events.
"It will not succeed," Rabia said to his son. "It will bring repression and terrible suffering upon us."
But because he was a proud member of his race, he continued to speak for the community, even when he disagreed with them. After several days of rioting, an uneasy silence had settled over the town. The banners, with their defiant messages, still fluttered above the barricades, and the young hotheads still patrolled the streets, attacking any immigrants foolish enough to show their faces. The older, wiser heads, led by Rabia, talked quietly together, their gazes flickering constantly to the east, beyond the town's outskirts, where the concrete ribbon of the highway, grey against the red-gold dunes that flanked it, lost itself in the desert haze. As darkness fell that night, Rabia, his face etched with worry, began to dig in the dry, stony soil of the walled yard behind their house. He carefully scraped off the top layer with his shovel and piled it to one side, then dug down into the darker earth beneath. When Sabit asked him what he was doing, his father merely put a finger to his lips.
"But is it a grave?" Sabit said, looking down into the deep, narrow trench his father was excavating.
A brief flicker of a smile crossed his father's face.
"Let us hope not, my son."
When he had finished digging, he took a length of rusting iron water pipe and drove it into the side of the trench near the top, at an angle that meant it broke ground a few feet from the trench. He buried it under a heap of stones and rubble, so it was invisible to anyone searching the yard. He disposed of the earth he had excavated by scattering it the length of the winding back lane behind the house. He broke up the old wooden store chest that had stood in their house since his grandfather's time, and used the wood and a piece of battered corrugated iron to roof over the trench he had made, leaving a narrow gap at one end that would be filled by the last piece of wood. He lowered an earthenware water jar, a metal container with a hinged lid, and a bucket into the trench, then scattered the topsoil he had removed over the corrugated iron. He sprinkled water on it and trod it down until it was indistinguishable from the trampled earth in the rest of the yard. He turned to face his young son.
"Now do you understand?" he said.
The boy shook his head.
"These are dangerous times, my son. Bad men are coming. I will be put in prison, and if they find you, they will take you too. When I tell you it is time, you must not hesitate for a second. You must climb down into the trench and stay there while I cover the top. Do not be frightened. There will be air to breathe from the pipe, and there is water and a little food. It will be dark, but by day there will be a little light through the pipe. Whatever sounds you hear, even if footsteps come very close, you must remain absolutely still and silent. When it is safe, I will come and get you. If I do not, you must..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.